Bachi, welcome to Hyderabad.
Thank you.
And welcome to the inaugural Anwar Ali Khan Memorial Lecture. I remember meeting Anwar outside film theatres just before we go into a film, and he always had his finger in a book, which is how I remember him. So it's a great pleasure to have you be the first person to speak at the memorial. I believe Anwar helped you with the book In Hot Blood, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Would you like to talk about that a little bit?
First of all, I want to say how happy I am to be here and how privileged I am to be giving this Anwar Ali Khan lecture, even if it weren't the inaugural one. Because I've known Anwar for very many years, and then of course I got to know Indrani as well. And I think really I must say this, because I say this to everybody, that what really touched me about Anwar was that he left his job in Bombay to come and look after his father in Hyderabad. Now that's not something that very many people do, and I think that is really the measure of the man, and for which I think he will always be very uppermost in my respect. He helped me in the book quite tangentially, because we had lost touch and I hadn't been coming to Hyderabad, though every time I've come to Hyderabad I have met Anwar, and this time it was really sad to come and not think that I was going to be meeting him. But when Rustam the film happened, and I have my own views on that film, but when it happened, the one good thing happened was that a lot of people wrote their memories of the case, and Anwar was one of them, because Anwar had been in school at that time, and he had been in school with one of the boys, though he was much younger. And then Anwar later on told me that, okay, he wrote this story, but he said that he was like 6 years old or 8 years old when this happened, and that it was a very salacious story, you know. Adultery was not something that anyone talked of in any polite company. His parents used to talk about it, and they would keep the blitz away. But he, of course, being a curious schoolboy, the minute something was kept away, he immediately went and got hold of it. And his parents were discussing something about the case, and this little boy piped up and said, "No, it wasn't like that." And they said, "What have you been reading that magazine?" And so his cover was blown. But he did write a bit at that time about his time in that class. One sec, Sridhar. Yeah. So, but just before this, there's a bit which somebody else had also described his time at that time, and that man had ended and saying, "Although I do not recall indulging in any of this personally," because they used to be pretty cruel to the kids who were there, because children can be quite unwittingly or even wittingly cruel. And he said, Nandan quotes this, like, you know, they used to learn this Shakespearean sonnet called "Who is Sylvia?" And they had got a rather salacious version of that, and they would kind of sing it, and he hoped that it was not in the child's hearing. And he said, "Sad to say, this song tended to follow Feroz in his last days of school. It was embellished only behind his back with unprintable language. Although I do not recall indulging in any of this personally, I carry a vague sense of guilt that I belong to a community of small boys who could be unspeakably rude and cruel." So Anwar Ali Khan, ad man and essayist, agreed with that assessment in an article prompted by Rustam. "I remember the case well." This is Anwar's writing. "I remember the case well, despite the fact that I was only 8 years old, possibly because the Nanavati's son, Feroz, was a schoolmate of mine. I recall him as a serious, sensitive kid with a kind of precocious dignity that was beyond his years. It was a dignity that would be tested harshly, because Feroz was 10 when it happened. So, you know, too young to really understand that these things happened, and yet old enough to know that lines and boundaries had been crossed and that his father was at the center of this storm. So when the Nanavati scandal broke, our entire school was agog with excitement because of the connection of Feroz. And it still fills me with a kind of secondhand guilt that the boys used to taunt him and sing a hit song of that time, Tom Dooley, with the words cruelly customized. Hang down your head, Nanavati, hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Nanavati, your father's gonna die. Oh, incidentally, Nanavati's, now this is me. Incidentally, Nanavati's swooning supporters outside the sessions court had sung the song differently, customized to Don't Hang Down Your Head, Nanavati.
Okay. As you'll have...
And then one second, then yeah. Afterwards, actually when I spoke to Anwar about this, he then put me in touch with his cousin, who had actually known one of Prem. How many people know this story? Everyone, right? Okay. So one of the, you know, one of the former girlfriends of Prem Ahuja, who he had eloped with when she was underage, and it had created quite a scandal at that time, and the parents were able to get her back because she was below the age of consent. Then she had been married, you know, and so everyone was deeply embarrassed when Prem Ahuja became the talking point.
So as you can tell, if you were young when the Nanavati case happened, you might have memories like Anwar's about it. If you didn't, you probably know about it at the very least through films like Rustam, or you know, perhaps even older ones from the 70s. But if you don't know anything about it, very briefly, the Nanavati case. Nanavati was a naval officer, a highly decorated one, expected to do really well. In 59, when he found out that his wife was having an affair with Prem Ahuja, a businessman, he requisitioned a gun, a pistol, and he went and shot him dead. Now, and then the case that followed became, you know, the kind of sensation that we see from time to time, perhaps once in a generation. I mean, I think the analog might be the Arushi murder case.
Yes.
And now the Indrani Mukherjee case. But the kind of media coverage of it, the fact that it was the last jury trial in the country, all of these things made it one of the landmark cases, both sensational, something that caught the public imagination, and was also very important as a legal thing. Bachi, I wanted to ask you, there are many things that draw one to a case, you know, I mean, there are all these things that we've just outlined, but personally, what drew you to it? When was the point when you decided, this is something I have to write about? And did you expect what it would involve when you began?
Well, I'll be, this is something I'm always told not to say, but being an honest person, I say it, is that the book was commissioned, actually just commissioned by Juggernaut, and I'm quite notorious for returning advances and tearing up contracts, and so this must have been, I can't remember how many books I've turned my back on, some where I've done a great amount of research, but you know, because you know I'm a journalist, so I kind of work in the here and now, and a book is like too much in the future, so I've been put off. But ever since I started curating the Times of India Literature Festival, there was a lot of pressure, why are you not doing a book yourself? Hmm. And so then when Juggernaut commissioned, and Juggernaut gave me this little sop and said, you know, do a quick book. So I said, okay, I'll do a quick book. Hmm. And that sounds easy. But when I began to read about this case, I realized that it was certainly not a quick book. And you know what drew me to the case first really, before anything, was the media part of it. That how, you know, how Rusi Karanja and the Blitz were really the de facto defense team of Nanavati. Mm. And how media can turn a story around. And today we all know about trial by media. But that was also trial by media, but in a completely different way, because it was complete support for the accused, not the other way around. And then when I began to read, because I didn't grow up in Bombay, I wasn't there, I had no idea about the kind of hysteria that this and if you will allow me, I'll read a bit from there.
Yes, please do, yeah.
But when I began to read it, I said, oh my God, this is a fabulous story, because, you know, for this kind of public interest to happen, the social part of it, the tension between the old guard, you know, commanding heights Parsis and the Ariviste Sindhis. So, you know, there was social drama, there was legal drama, there was urban drama. So I thought, well, fabulous. And then again, going deeper into another level, when I began to read the case itself, the judgments, which completely overturned what Blitz was writing about. Because it was so seductive to just read the Blitz reports, because they were written with all that class and drama and romance and, you know, stranger than fiction. But when you went into the hard, dull facts of judgments, you said, hey, this is completely different. And that is why the book has quite overturned a lot of the cliches of Nanavati being this unalloyed hero, you know. And I really came to the conclusion that he acted a great deal out of entitlement, which didn't make me very popular among the Parsis. Unfortunately, I didn't even become popular among the Sindhis, even though I did so much work to reinstate Prem Ahuja. So you just can't win.
Why was that?
You know, because they always read the first sentence of the chapter, and what was meant to be said as the cliche was taken at face value.
Oh, no.
You know, like, what was there not to like about the Parsis, and then what was there to like about the part to the Hindi, the Sindhis. So, you know, you were immediately damned on both sides. And that's the nature. Not that one, when one writes a column, one is looking for any popularity contest.
That's true. No, I was just going to say, why don't you read a little bit to give an overview of how this stuff works. You read the thriller?
Yeah. You know what?
Do you want to read the thriller?
Yes. You know what I'll do? I'll read the prologue only because to show why the case now. You know, when, why write a book about it now, when there have been 3 films, when there have the case is 59, so more than 50 years old. So, but it really did become an urban legend. So the prologue is called, so bear with me, it's a page and 2 pages. I'll try and read it fast. The Long Shadow of an Urban Legend. Way back on 27th April 1959, a Parsi naval commander, Kavas Nanavati, shot dead his English wife, Sylvia Sindhi lover. 3 bullets in less than 3 minutes is all it took. But the trial, which began the following September, held the nation in thrall for 5 years, and the story has continued to have an obsessive afterlife in films, books, even PhD theses. This is the first non-fiction book really on the case. And even the PhD thesis was about the afterlife in films
of the media.
So its immediate allure is easy enough to explain. This was India's first upper class crime of passion, and it titillated a society still in the socialist straitjacket. Pythagoras himself could not have come up with a more perfect right-angled triangle. Handsome naval officer in dazzling whites, seduced wife in repentant black, and the easily demonized dead playboy businessman. There was the unequal pitting of upright Parsi against quote-unquote unscrupulous Sindhi. The setting infused the tale with its own legend. Bombay was an urban grail, cosmopolitan Camelot, with streets paved with opportunity and stardust. The class, the caste, the context was such a triple whammy that they have knocked out all else. But those 3 quick shots fired by Commander Nanavati had a much wider reverberation, echoing right into the present. There are 3 main narratives that deserve greater engagement. The case, the high-octane drama from sessions to Supreme Court apart, the case honed fine points of criminal jurisprudence. It also pitted the executive against the judiciary in a way that is now happening again. That's my line now. Okay. It also foretold the way that elite mafias would manipulate the system to subvert justice. The Nanavati trial set a pattern. but it has also remained unique. In none of his high-profile successors, which bloodied every decade, were the topmost echelons of executive and judiciary locked in such a turf war. In none of them was a prime minister obliged to intervene. You know, Pandit Nehru had to come in and soothe the feathers of the press at his monthly press conference as to why a man of such influence, you know, was getting away literally with murder. Because the twists and turns of the case were something, if you haven't read the book and if you've only seen the movie, then I'm not going to give away the twists and turns. The media, courts are the de jure custodians of criminal justice, but a relentless fourth estate is often the de facto arbiter. In the hoary expression, vox populi, vox dei, the modern media, the voice of the people, increasingly arrogates to itself the voice of God. We all know who is the nation and who is the voice of God. This too began with the weekly newspaper Blitz's espousal of Nanavati's cause. In those days of black and white, Blitz managed to create a technicolor story. In both content and form, it became the masterclass for the covering of crime. The Triangle. None of the case's prodigious spin-offs has examined the extent to which privilege and prejudice loaded the dice of public perception. We have been even more coy about the complex man-woman equation within marriage and outside. Geometry's triangles are simple, not so the ones encompassed by chemistry. For too long we believed in those cliches of unalloyed hero, unmitigated villain, and his unwitting victim. They need to be deconstructed. Did something less edifying lurk behind the fanciful tapestry of love and honor woven by Nanavati's lawyers? How much of this upright officers were driven by his twice-born entitlements of Bombay Parsi background and the hothouse naval culture? Who was the human behind the multi-dimensional arch-villain, Prem Ahuja? Doesn't Sylvia deserve today's prism of empowerment? She should be seen as a woman who wanted something more than what her marriage gave her and actively went for it, eyes wide open or almost. And what of the aftermath? The Canada years have remained unexplored till now. We know that Carvis and Sylvia's reconciliation made the defense team's job easier. But how did they ultimately weather the storm, salvage their marriage, and script a new love story? Despite the energy expended for over half a century on L'Affaire Nanavati, it's not an open book, nor yet an open and shut case, not by a long shot.
Thank you, Bhaji. You know, like you just said, this is a case that's almost 60 years old. If people read crime fiction, this is what's called a cold case.
Yeah.
In crime fiction terms, most of the principals are dead. Most of the people that you might benefit by speaking to are also either very old or don't remember the details in quite the detail that you'd like. So you're left with either secondary sources or you have to try hard to find anyone who can help you with something new to say about the case. I mean, it's really fortunate that Ram Jethmalani is long-lived and he's around and you got to speak to him. But it's fascinating. Tell us how you found the people that you did speak to, especially given that Nanavati and his family emigrated to Canada in the late 60s. They began a new life. We know nothing about all of these things, you know, because everything ends with the end of the child and his freedom. So tell us how you chased these people down, how you found the people to speak to.
Okay, you'll have to interrupt me if I go on, because I can go on about this. And because, you know, it's really, I'm not an academician. My world is not the world of musty archives. Though, of course, musty archives were very important for me. But it's really, you know, real life people who kind of bring something different to the story. Because otherwise, it's very much the story as is known. But it was really a challenge. and it became a kind of joke among my friends that if I saw a Parsi over 80, I said, did you know the Nanavatis? And if I saw a Sindhi over 80, I said, did you know the Ahujas? But I must tell you that it worked, certainly in the Sindhi case.
Oh.
And yeah, and also it wasn't just that people were dead. You know, people don't have reliable memories.
Exactly.
So the challenge was not only finding someone who was alive, but finding someone with a you know, still intact memory. And there were really people said, oh, this person is fantastic, you must speak to him or her. And then when you went there, you know, they had Alzheimer's, they had a stroke, and it was like, oh my God, what am I going to do about this? and but you know, you persevere. That's why you've been a journalist all these years. And you go and you sit and listen to a drone for half an hour, hoping that one nugget will come out of it. And it did. Like, for instance, I went to this lady and I listened to her. And first of all, she took a lot of time convincing to be spoken to. Then she went on and on. But at the end of it, she came up with this lovely story, which she said that when Nanavati was born and his horoscope was being drafted, the astrologer said, this boy will shape the world. You know, and then when all this happened, the mother confided to this friend, and she said it in Gujarati, that dharelu bhi nahi ki evi rite thase, that we never thought that this is how it would happen. So you know, things like that. Then you know, again in a very serendipitous way, you know, I love this story of mine that you know, I don't know how many of you know of Gerson de Cunha. He's this big thespian of an ad man. He probably worked with Anwar. And so, because I didn't know anything about Bombay, and it's really important when you're doing a book to create context. So to create the context of Bombay, and there is a whole thing about, you know, Bombay, and then about how Bombay was a Parsi, you know. And so I wanted to recreate the Bombay of those years. So I SMS'd him and I said, you know, can I meet you? And I never heard from him, and Gerson is a friend of mine. Then I go to I'm kind of, you know, really battened down, don't go anywhere. But I go to this one particular party for another reason. And I see Gerson. And I say, Gerson, what is this? You don't reply to SMSs. And he says in his very lofty theatre voice, he says, oh, you know, my driver keeps my phone and my driver doesn't read SMSs. So I said, oh, but anyway, I said, now I don't really need you because I've, you know, found out enough about Bombay. He says, but you know, why? So I said, because I'm writing on the Nanavati case. And he says, oh, Nanavati, I used to party with Prem Ahuja. You know, until that point, like, Prem Ahuja was like not to be found, because he had, of course, died. His single sister was dead. He seemed to have had a brother in London, but like nobody came forward. And suddenly this man who, you know, and really this, with people under your nose, like there was a person who had, a woman who I heard, who had attended every day of the trial in Canada, I mean, sorry, in Bombay, but she had emigrated to Canada. And even though I had sort of, this person who I knew very well, knew her, and I tried every journalistic ploy in the book to get her to speak to me, you know, she had sort of closed that chapter. And also in Canada, they just didn't want to talk because they didn't want to open proxy wounds. You know, there was this whole, you know, this protective wall, you know, around the Nanavatis. And he continued to be a hero, even in Canada. Yeah. In fact, it added to his legend, the fact that he had fought this great, you know, thing of love and betrayal. Yeah, you can say that afterward. And but this woman refused to answer. Then I said, okay, fine, give up. And then I go for my haircut. And on the way back, I drop in at my cousin and his wife. They said, you know, where have you been all this time? I said, no, I've not been going out. I've been working on my book on the Nanavati case. And this cousin's wife said, oh, I went to the trial every single day. So there I had this whole thing. Then there was this, you want me to stop?
Yeah.
Let me say one more.
Okay.
One more. And so now I'm with one of the admirals, and one fellow walks in, and I'm again upset, and I said, why is this man cutting into my time? But he turned out to be such a gold mine of information, Mike. He had actually bunked college at Kharagvasla as a cadet and come to the trial. He said, I came to ogle all the young women who had collected. And then he goes on a cruise, like now. he went on a cruise and he very excitedly emailed me and he said, you know something, on the cruise there was a man who's, I met a man and they were like Parsis, so they started talking, and when he heard that Mike was in the Navy, he said, oh, you know, my cousin was Commander Nanavati. So oh he was his first cousin.
Wow.
So and so at once Mike, my agent, said, you know, will you speak to this lady? She's doing this story. He said, yeah, sure. So, but he was still on that cruise and he says going to get off in Paris in 3 days' time. He said his name is Firoz Bhandara. And a like kind of something clicked and I said, who is this Bhandara? Houston, former Karachi. And I said, oh my God, Bapsi Sidhwa, the novelist, was also a Bhandara. So I emailed her, and her I know, you know, professionally, and I've done. So she immediately wrote back and she said, yes, yes, he's my cousin, he was my cousin, and more than that, at that time I happened to be married to my first husband, and I was in Bombay at that time, and my mother-in-law came waving the paper and saying, look what's happened to your cousin. And so then she described all the scenes outside the court. Mm. So it was just fabulous.
I'm interrupting you, Bachi, only because you're giving away all the exciting bits of your book. So I think we should wait for people to buy it and
read it. Okay, all right. Okay, okay.
So, so here's the thing. I mean, the fact is that all these court cases, from the Session Court to the Bombay High Court to the Supreme Court and all of this, this was the crux of the thing. You know, the murder just happened and their lives resumed afterwards with difficulty. Mm-hmm. But the bulk of the story is in the fact that it took place in the courts.
Yes.
And honestly, for me reading this book today, that's the meat of it, you know, that's the heart of it. Because I think we listen to judgments today in the Supreme Court with as much avidity as these people mm-hmm. must have listened to the Nanavati case. You know, there's the privacy judgment, there's Section 377, there's Aadhaar. All of these arguments are actually gripping if you follow it,
right?
You know, and the thing is that we're not all legal people. We're ordinary lay people, but we understand something
right.
of all of these things. You've waded through judgments. You've waded through all kinds of stuff. And the thing I really like is the way that it's not dry. You know, you've given a sense of what that courtroom was like. You weren't there. You've spoken to people,
yeah.
but you've given us a sense of what it felt like to be in those rooms and those old heritage buildings, mm-hmm. listening to these
yeah.
judges, listening to the jury sitting over there, the crowds. It would be really great if you read something that
okay.
gave us a sense
all
of
right.
what that's like.
But I must tell you that, you know, those crowds, they were all very much pro-Nanavati. And if a hostile witness stood up, they would say, shut up, sit down. You know, that kind of thing actually happened. The galleries were so packed that, you know, plaster began to fall, and they...
How did you get this information? Was the secondary...
It's in the public record.
Okay.
It was there in the newspapers.
Oh.
It was there in the newspapers. Unfortunately, you know, Sessions courts don't have a... You know, they don't have a record, like
yeah.
court record. So that you had to largely get from the papers, and of course from people who were there as juniors,
yeah.
like Temtan Andyaru Jina, like Nader Modi, you know, who were juniors to H.M. Sirvai, and who actually worked then in those offices around the courts and could see the
yeah.
excitement. But more than the court,
yeah.
I mean, I will read the,
okay.
the, you know what, the excitement of the first day.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I'll try and skip through bits and pieces. Okay. So this is Flora Fountain, 23rd September 1959. Bombay had never seen anything like this, perhaps neither had all of India. Yes, bigger crowds had gathered earlier for national celebration or mourning. It would be a while before it reached its final denouement, but not even the charged atmosphere in and outside the Bombay City Court of Sessions that Wednesday provided a clue to the historic twists and turns the case would take over the next 5 years. Like fictional drama, this 20th century real-life passion play would keep requiring a suspension of disbelief. You needed to suspend it on day one itself. Here was a man who only the other day was unknown outside his own charmed circle, and he was charged with murder to boot. Yet he was getting a degree of adulation which later rock stars would kill for. True, the tallest of India's freedom struggle had been given a tumultuous reception. But the demographic was quite different. the patriotic crowds of the 1940s didn't comprise mainly hysterical women dressed to the nines, and they never threw love notes and lipstick smeared currency notes, even at the dishy Jawaharlal. Then I said, okay, everyone was like there. And okay, on this 23rd September, and getting more crowded as the trial progressed, the courtroom and its 2 kilometer radius was patterned with Bombay's entire ethnic mosaic. Gujaratis, Maharashtrians, Boras, Khojas, the Aligarh Ali, Bene Israeli Benjamin, Sandra from Bandra, and the diverse southerners lumped together under the label Madrasi. They had come from their cubby holes in Dalal Street, from shops in Crawford Market and Masjid Bandar, from the grand buildings of Ballad Estate, and from homes across the socio-economic range. Naturally, most in evidence were the two communities unhappily tied together in victim and accused, Sindhis and Parsis, the former seethed over the mood so palpably against their Prema Hooja. The minority Parsis were there in full force, charged up to cheer for the hero of the hour. Yes, the Parsis had come en masse. Meenu Masa and Mani Masi too, from Adi to Zarina, Soli Solicitor, Homi Homeopath, Jimmy Jim Khanawala, Eddie on his Royal Enfield, Fali in his trusty Fiat, Sillu, Hillu, Villu and Pillu. They came on local trains from Dadar, Grant Road, even Thana, on buses from Kulaba and Baikala, in chauffeured Chevys from Malabar Hill. They bunked college, deserted their typist pool at Central Bank and the Tata Companies. They came carrying hope in their hearts and strength in their forearms to elbow their way into this crush of humanity. Arthritic aunties and ponytailed pretties alike even knocked on unknown doors, pleading politely to be allowed onto the balconies of surrounding buildings as if to watch the motorcade of a visiting head of state. Then, yes, and they threw those lipstick missiles, even marriage proposals, in the fond hope of an imminent divorce. Hi, hi, bare baap re, what would prim mama say? But mamas were there too, jostling and screaming with the rest. You could safely presume that an intra-Parsi match or two was made in that incendiary atmosphere. Oh, but I must tell you something else, you know, which isn't in this paragraph, and I really must. And that is that, you know, the hawkers. So, you know, this thing had excited all this interest, and the hawkers of Bombay, always ready to seize the main chance, began to sell Nanavati pistols and Ahuja Tauliyas. Why? Because that was the fulcrum of the case. Ram Jethmalani, who was a very junior lawyer at that time, had been appointed by Mamie Ahuja to have a watching brief to say that her brother was not, ek to mar gaya, uske upar, you know, he was going to be savaged and ravaged. And he very cleverly pointed out that the defense has, you know, done this elaborate choreography of a scuffle, but how come that loosely, because you see, Ahuja had just emerged from his bath and when Nanavati stormed in and shot him. And so he says, well, if he just had that taulia on and there was this scuffle, how come, you know, the taulia was still on? So the hawkers started to shout, Nanavati ka pistol, bang, 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 Ahuja ka taulia, marega to bhi nahi girega.
Bachi, if you had forgotten, I was going to remind you of this.
No, no, I'll never forget that.
It's too great a detail to forget. And now here's the thing, you know, your details of things like the gun and the towel and people, you know, just knocking on strangers' doors to say, we want to stand over here to watch Nanavati come in. These are the kind of details that are amazing because they're true, you know.
Yeah.
And this is one case that's been such a draw for popular cultures. There have at least been 3 versions,
yeah, right,
film versions of it. There's Death of Mr. Love, Indra Sinha's, which is, you said, yes, the only fictionalized version. It's really hard to, you know, your imagination can think of many things, but they can't think of the things that have actually happened. If you were to I won't say critique, but if you had to say something about how this has been represented in popular culture, what are the things that you'd appreciate about how it's turned up in the imagination? And what are the things that are so terribly done they're missing because they're missing these details?
Right. You know, you said about imagination, but I think this is about nonfiction, narrative nonfiction, is that you really can't use your imagination.
Correct.
You know, you can just use your words to maybe, you know, put it a little differently when you are describing things, but you cannot put words into people's mouths. And I did have court records to go by, so they were very important. You had newspapers of that time. You had conflicting papers. You had the Blitz and you had the Current. And Blitz and the Current were the two tabloids of that time, and they were on politically polar ends. You know, Rusi Karanja was very leftist, Current was very rightist, and sometimes I think that Current wrote about the case only to criticize Blitz's coverage of it, you know. And there's really nothing that is fictionalized in this book, except I'll tell you one thing, that when I say that after the noonday confession, you know, lunch is served and they come down to sit and eat, and I said they sit down to their lunch of gravy cutlet and prawn curry rice. I mean, that I just had to, you know, just assume that that was it. And there is one factual error, which I hope there will be a reprint, and again, not for want of trying, because for all the lawyers I spoke to, all the family I spoke to, when I said, when did they go away to Canada? Because again, this was the ultimate entitlement, that a convicted murderer, even though he got a pardon, you know, was still fast-tracked and got this emigration to Canada. And they said, no, soon after, within the year. And after the book was published, a person came to me and he said, no, it was 4 years later. And I said, how do you know? So he said, well, I was in class with Feroz and I've got photographs to show our farewell party. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that was
they were all there.
And I think in critiquing, I think because the story, the twists and turns, the story is so seductive that it is so easy to romanticize and keep up this whole myth of the story of love and betrayal. The man, his wife betrays him, he goes and shoots the lover, you know, and but then it, I think, takes a degree of courage to bring this hero, you know, and I think, you know, give him a much more human character, and, you know, and say that, look, you know, okay, he, you know, it wasn't such a grand tale of John Bitwell. He just happened to be this Bombay Parsi who nobody could question. He had all these, this whole big guns arrayed on his side, the Navy, Mullah and Mullah. His uncle was a senior partner in the biggest law firm of Bombay. So he managed to really stay out of, you know, proper custody, which was, I mean, it rankled with me. Not, and I think maybe it helps that I wasn't a Bombay Parsi, that I could be a little more objective about it.
Yeah.
Because as I read it, you know, the public record somehow just sort of jumped up, and I just saw the whole unfairness of this whole thing, that, hey, this is entitlement. You know, you can't just go in and shoot a man, you know, and if he was such a big man of great thing, I mean, this is called hot blood. Mm-hmm. But the court cases really said he shot him in cold blood.
Yeah, that's true. So, I mean, Bachi, this book required the kind of research, you know, that takes a few years out of your working life. But what you do on a day-to-day basis is write your column, Erratica, which is what, you know, I've seen the copies of books in people's hands all evening today. And this is what, you know, anybody will know you for. We've all read you for years. We've read your column. And you write about so many things. You know, this second collection of your columns, it begins with on a very personal note, mm-hmm. but there are columns on politics, there are columns on sport, there are columns, you know, public events, but also just lighthearted, family, all kinds of things. So tell us how you keep going for 25 years writing a column. I get bored after three years at the most.
Well, it actually gets easier.
Yeah.
It really does get easier when you find your voice, you know, you find the rhythm of it. And my God, this country gives you material like it kind of overwhelms you.
That's true.
Yeah, it really overwhelms you. And I think it's, you know, the Chinese have a saying which says, you know, and it's a curse. May you live in interesting times. And I wish we would live in even more interesting times.
Oh my God.
I mean, like, yeah, like, you know, really, like the last three columns have all been about Me Too. Then I have to also kind of remember that, okay, Erratica is a satirical column, but I mean, when I want to be serious, then I do use this, but it is 400 words.
Correct.
And I think you wanted to...
It's really difficult to kind of condense everything that you want to say in such a short space, you know, in a newspaper column. What's, for you, what's the funnest thing that you've written? Which column? I know it's 25 years is a lot of time from which to choose, but there must be something that you really, you know, there are moments when you're writing and you say, yes, this is coming out just perfectly, and it's a song to write it. So what are your memories of?
That's a very tough one. Really don't think I know. I'll tell you what. I'll tell you that everything doesn't. You know, many people say, "Oh, you write as if you know you've dashed this out and or you've written it. It flows." They don't say dashed it, and that would imply that it was a very careless piece of writing. But it looks as if you know it's just come out spontaneously. But it doesn't happen. There's nothing that I've written in 20 minutes. It takes me a good part of the morning. Yeah. And now, because it has been reduced from 700 words to 600 to 400, it's actually taking me longer to cut it to size than it is to write.
Yeah.
And I actually don't just count the words. I don't do word count. I do character count, which because I mean, it is 2, 4, 4, 2 characters, you know. And because it can be 307, like today's column is 2, 4, 4, 2 characters. But it is 370 words, then it's not 400 words. So words are not, and you have that set thing.
Space.
And I give the headline, I give the second line. I don't, you know, want anyone cutting that column. And I'll tell you what happens. You know, sometimes you have this play on words and you kind of play around with words, you create words. And that's wonderful, but it also has a dark side to it. Because someone made a genuine mistake, people think, oh, that must be something that she's thought of. And our kinky brains haven't been able to come up with it. So sometimes that does happen. But I'll tell you, I think I like, and surprisingly, I don't do it so much more, but so much these days, but I write with the greatest of ease on food.
Oh, lovely.
My friends have told me that I write most engagingly when I talk about death and people who have, you know, friends who have passed on. And so I don't know why I'm writing a humor column, because nobody tells me you're writing the greatest humor column.
You know, they say the same thing about me when I write about it, so there we go. So you must be getting feedback from your readers, Times of India. I mean, I don't think the Times of India publishes letters to the editor when it comes to columns like yours, but you must be seeing feedback.
They've reduced that column space fully.
So what's the most interesting feedback that you've got? I mean, you know, has it set you off on a new column? Has it made you angry? Has it made you pleased? What's the most interesting?
Okay. You know, actually, you should, there's no such thing as bad publicity. And you know, I'm very happy to take criticism. What is happening today, trolling, you know, that I do not read.
Yeah.
Because there are people who've actually said, oh, you know, and she doesn't even know how to write English. Now, if I don't know how to write English, then I don't know what I know, you know. So that can be, you know, that can be very, very disheartening.
Yeah.
And it can make you stop writing forever. I'll tell you, you know, I mean, if you start worrying about what people are saying, you really wouldn't write a line. I'll tell you that it doesn't happen so kind of thing. I remember, like, I used to write, you know, like we write bongs, gatis, you know, that sort of thing. And I got this like really dirty handwritten postcard which said, "We have noticed that, you know, you have been using this word ghati too often in your columns. Be aware." all fear and acid attack on your photogenic face.
Oh my God.
And I was about to write my next column saying, Mr. Thakare, it was that, please tell me what is wrong with the word Ghati. And then I was immediately told by family and friends, look, please, they'll shoot first and ask questions later.
Yeah.
So, yeah. But I don't think you can worry. You really can't worry. And I think you get away. You get away with much more, you know, with satire, subtle satire. And I think it's really, I think you can say much more. You get away much more, but you can say much more. Because I think the bludgeon versus the stiletto, it's far more effective.
Yes. And I mean, Bachi, we know that humor is really hard to do, and you've sustained it for so many years to the delight of your readers everywhere. Thank you very much for being here. I think we'll open it out to questions from the audience. Vikram, will you? Yeah. A round of applause for Bachi Karkaria, please. Thank you, Bachi.
I'll keep the mic. They'll pass the mic.
So, friends, we have a delightful conversation.
Thank you
very much for that and your questions.
Good evening, ma'am. Thank you for the talk. Ma'am, you have been observing media and journalism things for the last many decades. So how has it changed over the years, and what advice do you have for upcoming and new journalists? Thank you so much.
Well, certainly media has changed. I started with Khushwant Singh in 1969. And I can't tell you how fortunate I am that I started with him, because he was this really irreverent editor, and I think I learned about the deflation of, I mean, he used to write about gas bags. In fact, one of his books is that about, you know, gas bags and bores, you know, of India. So I think maybe some of that rubbed off. I don't ever claim to have filled his shoes. But I think from that point, I realized that, you know, you don't have to be so pompous. And if you ask me at the last part about the advice you would give, it would be the advice that, not that he gave it, but which I followed from his example, that take your work very seriously, but don't take yourself too seriously. Unfortunately, today's journalists, many of them are doing it in reverse. They're just getting so pompous and forgetting the whole craft and, you know, what journalism is about. And I think what we've also forgotten, the old dictum about that news is sacred and comment is free, is today you, especially television, you know, you don't know where the news is in that. There's really, as the ad says, noise. And I don't understand, you know, how you can have what passes off as a debate when nobody can hear what anybody is saying, you know. I mean, it's absurd. And I think children should never watch it, because they'll really learn the worst manners possible to really talk over each other. And I know that I sometimes have, you know, learned this, because very recently I was doing a radio thing for BBC, and the man was asking me something, and I sort of butted in, and he said, "No, excuse me, don't talk over me." You know, he actually had to tell me that, you know. So I think, see, a lot has changed, and I won't say it's change for the worse, because, you know, change is change. And of course, I mean, like, what I'll tell you, you know, there was a thing which has happened, like, now it's different. Maybe in the 90s, I think what we call media morphosis, and I think it coincided with what was happening in the country. That first we were in this very socialist straitjacket, where the public sector occupied the commanding heights, politicians couldn't be questioned, and editors also cast themselves in that same role, and they lived in the ivory tower. They never really wondered about what readers wanted to read. And if you said, give the reader what you want, you would be accused of completely trivializing the paper. I've forgotten that word that they used. Anyway, but when we really began to put our ear to the ground, we realize that, you know, we've just been very statist. We've been having just the politician's point of view. Even the pictures were all deish shots of these stuffed suits or people lolling on their gaddas, which happened in, you know, say the Congress working committee. So then Khushwant Singh actually brought in this thing. No deish shots, no anything like this, no pictures without a human person in it, no gas bags. So, you know, stuff like that. And so that is what changed when we began to really hear the market. You know, now to say the market to journalists is again high treason. But if you think of market as reader, you really begin to write about real subjects.
Hmm.
And I think that is what has happened. And it's not a bad thing at all. What is happening today with social media, I mean, again, I'm speaking like a like an old-fashioned journalist, that it is really unprocessed information. It's really like what you would call the privilege of the harlot, that is power without responsibility. And so you have to be very, very careful. And now today we've got fake news. So we really don't know. So it's very tough. I think don't read the news at all. Better be safe.
Bachi, on 26 November 2008, I think it was your son's wedding in Colaba. Can you describe what happened on that fateful day?
Well, there's a chapter, there's a, one of the columns in this book, in this one. It's called The Terrorist at My Table. And a friend of mine, a very dear friend, came from Delhi for the wedding. She was Sabina Saikia. And she was this big foodie. So I kind of expected her to like stay till the end, but she ate in the first part, went back to the Taj and got killed in that attack. And so it was a really horrendous thing, because, you know, first we began to just, you know, we heard these, you know, gunshots. First we thought crackers, then there was this thing, oh, there's been some gang warfare on Colaba. Then someone said, no, there's a rogue shooter who has entered into the Taj. And then Suhail Seth, who poor man, or well, not poor man, who's now in very bad odor, he was there and he got the first call from the Taj saying, please don't come back, and we've arranged for you all to go to the president because, you know, we are under a terrorist attack. And then our own people were coming, you know, and a lot of people somehow narrowly missed. So the first week the first time I wrote about the terrorist at my table. And then so many people called me and I had this terrible sense of guilt that, you know, what am I going to ever face up to the kids of Sabina? And even though her own family told me, Bachi, you can't take this guilt on yourself, you know, it is something that haunts me today. But there were so many people who said, Bachi, if we hadn't been at your son's wedding, we would have been there. Because people kind of really, that kind of crowd kind of, you know, moves between the Taj and the Oberoi, and it did happen. So then the next time I wrote my column, The Savior at My Table. So, no, it was terrible, yeah. And everybody remembers my son's anniversary, yeah. And in fact, my son kind of then, instead of going to the Taj where they were supposed to be going for their like honeymoon, whatever, night, they came back, poor things, back to the house, and as usual, they're from America. So they started keying in, both of them sat at their laptops and started sending out messages. And my son's, I remember he said, I always wanted a memorable wedding. Be careful what you wish for.
Bachi, I was going to talk to you about something else, but it reminded me that, you know, the nation also wants to know some things. Like, for example, what's happened to Indrani Mukherjee and that Meeta Mukherjee story. You know, there's so much at one time, and then they keep quiet. But my initial question to you was about your Me Too moment with Khushwant Singh.
Oh, no Me Too moment. You know, really, this is, you know, sometimes I wonder, sometimes I really, you know, there's this joke. I'm sorry to laugh about it. It's not something to be joking about, but there is this joke that this woman goes to her boss and says, look, all the women in the department have, you know, charged you with a Me Too moment, so I'm going to charge you for discrimination. But really, I think I've been singularly lucky. And this is the thing, that Khushwant Singh, self-portrayed as the dirty old man of India, you know, was really the safest environment to work in. It really was. Oh, but you remember that story? Okay, all right. Okay, so he came to Hyderabad. He came to Hyderabad and he brought one of those typical, you know, those bangles with the glass stuck on it. It was a very large size, and he said, I said, oh, thank you, and I took it. He said, no, let me put it on for you. I said, oh, okay. And he said, I'm making a pass at you and you can't even figure that out. So I suppose I was such a dead loss that then nobody bothered.
There's a question.
Madam, I'm not going to ask you anything about your book. I would like to get some information because you have been working with Parsis and all the people. So we don't know, generally when we compare the Parsis in India with Jews in the US, both are very intelligent and communities are very small and many people are there. When we talk about Parsis, you know about only Atada and one or two families are there in Hyderabad. Can you tell us what is the origin of Parsis, if you know? Yeah,
please. Let me tell you that Jahangir Bisni is right here in your ranks, and he has made it his business to pick up every single article which has the word Parsi in it and send it out to his mailing list. So you better become his friend and he'll put you on the list. But if you really want the, and correct me, Jahangir, if I'm at all wrong, but they came from this area, Pars in Persia. They came about 1,000 years ago. They came because they had been, you know, they had the Zoroastrian empires, the Achaemenian and the Sasanian. But after the Arab conquest, there was a lot of pressure on them, and they fled really to prevent proselytization, and to save their ancient faith. So they came in these boats and landed in Gujarat and lived well, happily ever after, and fightingly ever after now.
Bhaji, I have a question. In the last 30 years of your work, you just mentioned that
Kushwant Singh... I've been very polite. It's closer to
40 years.
You just said that Kushwant Singh did say that you should not take oneself very seriously. But what I notice now is that people are taking somebody else very seriously. And every comment they make, every line they write, every word they say is analyzed threadbare. And some weird sort of meanings are brought up. Do you see this as a welcome change because of what we are being more transparent? Or do you see this as we are underemployed and we have nothing else to do except comment on others?
You know, I think this has got a lot to do with the change in media, where it is so much more interactive. And this is really that, you know, today everybody, nobody passively consumes news, but has become a very active consumer of news. And it's because today interactivity is so easy. You know, you can immediately, you know, the scroll is always happening under television, on the net, you can immediately write. So everybody wants to express their opinion. And the easiest person to express an opinion on and to get attention is for someone who's in the limelight. And I guess it's because of that. And it's really a lot about me, having my say. You know, me too without the hashtag.
Thank you, ma'am, for the talk. Who's your favorite journalist?
I will say Kushwant Singh. Kushwant Singh was definitely my favorite journalist. I mean, someone like, and with the kind of, if you're today, you're talking of today. You know, I think I've admired different editors for different reasons. I've admired, you know, journalists who have stayed the course, written long form in an age of the instant writing. And I think I'll be more generic about it. That as a professional myself, I can see where work is done, and I think I respect people who do a lot of legwork for their stories and don't just, you know, pick up a phone or, you know, look at some archives or look at some background material. And again, it's something that you know, we really did learn. Like, see, Kushwant Singh, loosened up media in a way it had never been. It was really, if you'll pardon the expression, very tight-ass. And in the Raman's time, it was always Raman himself, bowing before some godman or the other. And it was very high culture. Whereas Khushwant Singh, really brought it down to, I'll tell you this, see, in the 90s, we were all credited with kind of creating reader-friendly media. Because at that time, we were all senior, and then we, did this with the Times of India and all that. But when you go back and think about it, in the 1970s, Khushwant Singh had really created everything that, that we were doing afterwards. We were just being, derivative. Because in things about, write about people, what people are interested in. So rather than writing about Hari Prasad Chaurasia, he would write about Shakila Banu Bhopali. He himself went and sat in the whole trial of Raman Raghav, who was that rock murderer, who used to kill people with a stone. He was that psychopath. Then he said, always start your stories with an anecdote. The way he taught us that, even a caption between the headline, the intro and the caption, you should have got the gist of the story. And we really worked more on a caption than people are today working on their whole stories. And we didn't have Google, we didn't have things like that. So we had actually like RGK, R. Gopal Krishna, who was this encyclopedic, person. And you kind of go to him and ask him, and he was one of those very crusty people. And you'd first think 200 times before you actually went and disturbed him. And I used to say, if I go and work in a place, where there is no RGK, what am I going to do? And when I went to the Statesman and I was writing third edits, then I was writing on subjects which were not being archived, in the Statesman archives. So I had to kind of, build my own archive and, cut and all that. And then as you write, you start collecting your own stuff, and then sometimes you go back to your own stories. So that same son of mine who's a journalist, the one who got married on 26/11, once I had my column in front of me when I was writing something, and he said, "Mom, now you started plagiarizing your own work, you hit rock bottom." So kids, so yeah. It's like that, and what was your question, journalist?
Which journalist did you admire?
Oh yeah,
so you
sorry.
Said Khushwant Singh.
I'm so sorry. No, so it's really,
there.
I don't know. And journalists who I've admired at one point, I have stopped admiring. Because they've become really embedded in this whole Modi cult, and they were brilliant journalists, and I'm really, really saddened to see what they are doing to themselves and their own reputations. So
Pachi, you've written this very serious book, I'm sure, Murder in Cold Blood, a premeditated murder. But your style has always been tongue-in-cheek, satirical, or at least the works that I have read. I don't think you've written anything apart from, that kind of style. So how difficult was it to write this book, which I'm sure is not funny.
Before you answer that, let me tell you, you can't put this book down. It's a page-turner. So it may be serious, but there's a lot of fun stuff going on. So it's not going to be one of those books where you're like, oh my God, another court report. No, you'll be turning the pages quickly.
In fact, I was really impressed because like the blurb, given by Fali Nariman, I didn't even know that Fali Nariman, this great lofty man, knew a word like unputdownable. And that's what he has put. And this is what I really liked, that in all the reviews, they've written and said that this is investigative journalism at its best. And at the same time, it's got this thriller style. And it wasn't difficult. Because you see, when you've collected the right kind of material, or when you've taken the trouble to get material, then a story really writes itself. And I mean, the other serious book I did, which was 10 years, more than that, 20 years earlier, was a biography of M.S. Oberoi. And that book also wrote itself. But that book wrote itself because I really kind of came to admire what that man had done. Mm. So when you get inspired, A, by a person or by a subject, and you've done your homework, then it's easy to write. Because it's only when you don't have material that you start padding, you know, you start, you know, working around it. So the when you ask me really about you know, what advice I would give, it would really be about you don't cut corners in this. And I say this in all the media training, that you can write a story with 5 interviews and you can write it with 15, and the difference will at once show. Because you are able to then sift and distill and take the best. And this case itself was just, I mean, it was so remarkable in its twists and turns. And I've quoted Tom Wolfe, where he says, the trouble with non-fiction is that it has to be plausible. Whereas with fiction doesn't have that problem. And you know, really this story is stranger than fiction.
Yes.
That is why I feel that somehow a movie like Rustam, you know, just didn't do justice to it. And what I really didn't like most about Rustam was the way that they cast Rusi Karanja as this absolute buffoon. And Rusi Karanja was one of the suavest men, Clark Gable like, you know, who you'd ever have met.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much, Bachi, for this wonderful evening.